can be divorced from the advertising PR machine? Or do you think, as Baralat says, that the advertising machine has colonised art and taken it over? Is there any art produced that is not a part of that machine now?
Yes, it is, but it's not at prime scene. It is, but you know what happens? It's not the question, it's not so much about discovering those artists or this art that is hidden somewhere because they didn't have the chance or the rights, if you want, to be advertised and promoted and so on. It's not that problem. The problem is, again, to change completely the general context into which we perceive and we name art, something like art, an activity, we call it art. If we do not change this perception, this context, to change the perception, we need to change the context. Anything that is going to be produced, it's going to be produced via advertising, PR, and the rest, because it's a huge industry globally. That it's like a petrol industry, like I don't know, airplane business, etc. You can't do anything. You cannot divorce art from advertising. What you need to do is to change the very sense of the name and the perception of. So I had a conversation with a Greek curator and journalist, and he about art and about the possibilities of change and all this stuff. And he mentioned something that's very interesting, that when Marcel Duchamp at the Armory Show, 24 when it was, exposed for the first time the famous Pissoir
fountain.
He was not renovating, morphologically speaking, the art. He was not creating a new form. He was making a political statement, a political gesture. How we say in English? Kinesic.
Gesture.
Yes. And what was this gesture? He was, at the period, you had what? You had all these movements, Dadaism, Surrealism, early Cubism, Expressionism, Russian Constructivism, and all this stuff. The reverse engineered of the formal, with Kandinsky and the others. The appearance of the abstraction at the scene. And artists were flattering themselves with the idea that they can do anything they want. They do not have limits. And he just showed them by this gesture their limits. He said, no, you have limits. And these limits are imposed by a political scene outside your formation. Of course, during the 20th century, this political gesture was absorbed into the cultural world. But it took years. If you think a bit, Duchamp became really world known outside the cycles of art only in the 60s.
He declared that it was the end of art with the fountain.
In a way,
yeah,
like because it was the end of the frame context into which art, painting, or sculpture was inscribed until this period. From the last movement of 19th century Impressionism, that was still a painting, I mean an object. It was of course a different painting, Seurat or Sisley or even Van Gogh, he was a post-Impressionist, they were doing another kind of painting than David or the Olders. But still it was an object painting. With the apparition of the fountain of Marcel Duchamp, we go to a completely destruction of a frame context and into a new one that took years to be reframed. But Duchamp didn't execute a formal, aesthetic, morphological gesture. He did a political gesture. That's the difference. So, if you want to have today something that worth the name art, or maybe another name, this will come from the change of the political frame context. It's another question.
Yes, because I'm wondering whether, in a way, Duchamp, by declaring the end of art, he was also declaring with the ready-made that anything can be art. And now we have a crisis economically in terms of eco capitalism, if you like, and the, you know, the recognition of the globe, of the earth as a single finite resource.
Mm-hmm.
But also we have a multiplicity, a heterogeneous idea that forms and polymorphic structures can coexist within that limited framework. That is this, do you think, also a crisis for art, which has persisted in spite of Duchamp to move along the idea of a formal progression, like capitalism has a need for ongoing profit? We have now a collapse of that discourse, if you like, or of that machine system. The gallery system, I think, is in a state of crisis. The internet and the web, it's a sort of an immaterial, pixelated dispersal of the materiality of art. At the same time, we have a new fixation on the materiality of paint or of sculpture or of any kind of materiality as it is presented to us, as it sort of disappears in a Foucauldian sense. Do you think that this has opened up a new possibility for what we call art? Or do you think that, because I think art as a term is constantly plastic, and that's one of its beauties. It's not something like, you know, a very limited, rigid idea. By its nature, it constantly morphs and changes. So Duchamp sort of ended it, and then he opened it up again. Like maybe Warhol also.
Warhol is the, it's exactly the opposite of Marcel Duchamp. That's the reason that a lot of people are confused by thinking that the Brillo installation, you know, the box is Brillo box, is something like a ready-made. No, it's not.
No.
Warhol was a retrogradation of a so-called revolt, the Duchampian revolt. Warhol took back the industrial object, the any object, the political gesture of Marcel Duchamp, to the corporations. He reframed art. If Marcel Duchamp opened up the space, he provoked a rupture with the context, the frame context. Andy Warhol, he, how we say,
Swing.
He recoudre. Questo elemento strabo.
Swing.
He shoo back the holes. So Warhol is not a continuation of Marcel Duchamp. It's exactly the opposite. But to come back to your question.
Can I just ask you there then? Because from my point of view, Duchamp declared the end of the sacred object.
Yeah.
Warhol rose up, raised and questioned the role of the sacred image.
No, he sacralized. He sacralized the a can.
No, but the can.
He sacralized.
This is where I disagree with you, because I don't think he had any interest at all in the object of the can. He was only interested in pure image, and
the image of the advertisement.
Yeah, but he then...
That's exactly what I mean. It's that he took a can as an image and he baptized it art, so a sacred object again, for the favor of the industry that was producing Brillo, or later with his famous prints on the accidents and violent acts that were happening in the period. What was that? It was the sacralization of the media, of a corporation that was taking birth at the period. So Duchamp did exactly the opposite.
See, I think Warhol is more radical than that. I think he, if you look at the way in which he silkscreened those images, they gradually disappear. With each silkscreen, he reproduces ad infinitum, but it's not a perfect copy. It's not a, it's a dissolution. It's the erasure of the image. So on the one hand...
Yeah, this is a secondary effect on his painting. Many artists before or simultaneously or after Warhol, they were working with the form this way. But it's not on the form, the problem.
No, it's a conceptual...
I mean, Warhol, it's not an artist that we are talking about him right now because he was a good painter. He was a pathetic painter. He didn't even know how to draw a line. But it's not that the value of Warhol. The value of Warhol was lying somewhere else. Was lying into his relation with the context. It was much more clever than an artist among the frame context of the movement. Sorry, of the pop art of the period. Jasper Johns was miles away a better painter. He was even a Wittgenstein painter, if you think want. I mean, he was thinking into the Wittgenstein analysis on his works and so on. As a painter, he's much more interested than Warhol. But Warhol is Warhol because he reframes the relation between the industrial object and the advertisement or the media or whatever, corporate. And this is the genius thing about his work, if we can call it genius. But not as a painter. A painter, why? What is interesting in his painting? Nothing. I don't see something.
Well,
but I want.
Anyway, we digress because
yeah, okay.
I think he's much more.
He's much more
perverse than that, because he began in advertising and he's actually a very good drawer and he's a very good illustrator and he's a very good English
maybe
maker.
Illustrator.
But he
I think
he,
some he, others they were doing their
but anyway,
silk screens.
Yeah.
He had a factory, if I remember.
That's right. And I think that's where his part of his advancement of things is, that he split off into different.
But you asked something else. You said something else. You talked about all this multiplicity of relics, of art objects, of cultural objects,